Thank you everyone for coming. I see a lot of familiar faces out there. It's pretty amazing. Thank you for that introduction, Melissa. Thank you for that riveting talk. I've practiced this talk a couple times, and I haven't been able to get through it without crying. So if you see me crying today, there's a good reason for it. I just haven't been able to get through it without crying. Today we're going to talk about what I title Behind the Curtain, a never-before-seen look at cancer survivorship. In 1982, when I was 7 years old, I met my maternal grandmother for the first and last time. And the most poignant memories I have of her include the rancid smell of vomit enveloping the air around me, the sound of uncontrollable retching reverberating throughout the room, and the buckets of vomit on the floor next to her bed. You see, my parents immigrated to this country from Egypt the year before I was born, and we didn't have a lot of money when I was growing up. So I thought it was kind of strange that at the age of 7, 1982, my mom was whisking me and my brothers to Egypt to go and see my grandmother. What I would soon learn was that my grandmother had just been diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer, and the only reason she was taking chemotherapy was so she could meet us. When I walked into the room where she resided in the bed, I remember the way the heat in Cairo in the summer of 1982 clung to my skin, as did the smell of her rancid vomit at the bedside. I remember looking at her and thinking she had no semblance of vitality, that there was no energy left in her. And as I got to the bedside and stood next to her, she somehow managed to get herself up and to hold me, to hug me, to kiss me, to smile at me. That was the last time I ever saw her. She died shortly thereafter. When I was 4 years old, whereas other kids were playing outside, my dad used to take me to his laboratory at the Veterans Administration in Minneapolis, where he was doing research on certain types of cancers, prostate and liver cancer. And whereas other children were outside playing basketball and football, I was learning how to dissect mice and rats and studying cancer in that context. First time I ever saw a cancer cell under a microscope, I was 4 years old. And despite the fact that I spent much of my childhood in that laboratory, I was far more interested in playing with the rabbits and the guinea pigs than I was in dissecting them. But yet, I'm still here. William Jennings Bryan once said, "Destiny is a matter of chance. Destiny is not a matter of chance, it's a matter of choice. It is not a thing to be waited for, it is a thing to be achieved." I spend most of my life trying to live by this adage to control my own destiny. But as many of you in this room know, you can't really do that for the most part. You can to some extent, but for the most part, you can't. When I look back at how I became a cancer doctor, I can't discern a single moment when I said, I'm going to be a cancer doctor. What I can tell you is that this path was laid out for me at a very young age, and I just never deviated from it. I never really thought of being anything else. For me, becoming a cancer doctor was more of a calling than it was a choice. My wife and I had been trying very hard to have children, and just in the moment we thought we weren't going to be able to, we found out she was pregnant. So I managed to get 10 minutes in my day between patients to go and see the first ultrasound. And as I'm learning for the first time that we're going to have twins, I can't stop thinking about the fact that I have to go tell my next two patients in 5 minutes' time that they're going to die in the immediate future. I can't do anything more for them, that their cancer would take their life and take their life very, very soon. Since 2012, when I came to St. Luke's, I've lost well over 100 patients. 3 weeks ago, I had three patients die in the same day. Yesterday, I saw 30 people between the clinic and the hospital. 17 of those people have a cancer that no one on the planet knows how to cure, that will ultimately take their life. 3 of those people will die in the immediate future because they're already enrolled in hospice. So it is my patients very frequently will ask me how it is I do what I do. There is a tremendous honor in having a patient give you what they hold most precious. But that's not what gets me through the day. What gets me through the day is that as a cancer doctor, I get to see love in quintessential form. Now, Webster's Dictionary characterize this love as a strong affection for another arising out of kinship or personal ties. And it also has this very complex definition. But I'm no expert on love. But for me, love has always been more of an action than a word, something you can never really convey in words, and something that I've actually learned from my patients and their family members. It manifests in the way a spouse will endure all levels of torture, all levels of discomfort, so that they never have to leave their loved one's bedside when they're in the hospital for a month or more. It manifests in the way entire families will drop everything they are doing to come to the office with a patient who was just diagnosed with cancer. It manifests in the way family members will scour the internet trying to find any way to help the person they love. When I was at Stanford, I used to moonlight on the hematology and oncology service to make extra money. So moonlighting as a doctor, that's where you'll work at night to make some extra money. And so one thing I hated about moonlighting on that service was that I was responsible for pronouncing patients dead. So when a nurse identifies that a patient's expired, they then call the doctor, and the doctor has to come and confirm that the patient has died. I used to hate that, because more often than not, the patient had never met me before, their family members had never seen me, and I never wanted to be a part of that moment. I did everything I could to avoid being a part of that moment. I remember one time, I walked into the room, and these two huge boys, this patient's sons, in their 20s or 30s, both were uncontrollably crying with their heads on his chest. So I tried to blend into the scenery to very quickly confirm the patient had died and leave the room. When I left the room, his daughter, who's in her 20s, is standing there, and I tell her, "I'm really sorry for your loss." She immediately grabs me and holds me for 10 minutes, and in that 10 minutes, she's shaking so hard that I'm actually shaking also, because she's shaking so vigorously. And it is in her shaking, in that embrace, there's this tremendous manifestation of love in quintessential form. Now, even though the family members of my patients have shown me what love is in an amazing way, what has had the biggest impact on me is the displays of love exhibited by our patients. It's not uncommon for me to have to walk into a room and tell a patient for the very first time that I'm meeting them that no one on the planet can cure their cancer, that it is going to take their life, and that the goal of therapy is to try and prolong their life and make it of good quality. Patient with metastatic pancreatic cancer, I tell them I have a regimen I can give them, chemotherapy. It's very intense. It's likely to make you sick. And what it basically does is extend your average chance of living 5 months, 5 to 6 months, to about 11 to 12 months. And despite that, it never ceases to amaze me how quickly patients are willing to take the treatment, to do what is necessary to extend their life. I think that the reason why they're so willing to extend their life is so beautifully depicted in this particular song, which I'm now going to play for you.
Turn away. If you could get me a drink of water, 'cause my lips are chapped and faded, call my Aunt Marie. Help her gather all my things and bury me in all my favorite colors, my sisters and my brothers still. Turn away, 'cause I'm awful.
Jim Goulet is a man, not a patient of mine, a story that I read about, who died of breast cancer 2014. And his wife, February 2015, on Valentine's Day, got flowers and a card in the mail. And the card had his cell phone number on it. So she called her children, asking them if they had sent her the flowers and the card. They said no. So she called the floral store where the flowers had been sent from, and they told her that 8 months before, Jim had come into the floral store and told them to send her flowers for every year for the rest of her life. When they asked her about it, when she was interviewed, she said, this act of love to me is just true love in its purest form. When I first came to Stanford, literally my first month at St. Luke's, I was called at 1 a.m. by the emergency room because they had just diagnosed a patient with acute myeloid leukemia. So I walk in the room, and in front of me is this amazing 33-year-old female who has 3 kids under the age of 7. And I'm telling her that she has acute myelogenous leukemia, a disease that kills 4 out of 5 people in 5 years. So she goes through induction chemotherapy, which lands her in the hospital for a month. She goes through consolidative chemotherapy, which lands her in the hospital for 2 weeks because she ends up getting a strep infection. And then she goes through an allogeneic stem cell transplant, bone marrow transplant, one of the hardest things that people go through in my field. 40 days after the transplant, find out her disease came back. Not just that, shortly thereafter, she gets a parainfluenza infection. Now, a parainfluenza infection in a person with a normal immune system, not a big deal, relatively innocuous. In someone who had just gone through a transplant with acute myelogenous leukemia who has no immune system to speak of, it's oftentimes fatal. So the morning that we realize that I'm gonna have to intubate her and put her on the ventilator to help her breathe, she tells me, as we're about to put her on the ventilator, "You do whatever it takes. I will endure whatever level of torture, whatever level of pain I have to, for you to wake up so that I can see my kids again." She never woke up. She died shortly thereafter. Many of you have probably read this story in the Duluth Tribune about Shirley Shaw. It's actually quite an amazingly well-written story. Shirley was a patient of mine who I met when she was roughly 73 years old. She had metastatic fallopian tube cancer that I couldn't cure, but we gave her chemotherapy pretty much indefinitely to try and extend her life. And when her family is with her, she would tell me that she wanted chemotherapy, she wanted to live, she wanted to enjoy her life, etc. Behind closed doors, when it was just me and her, she would tell me if it were up to her, if she was alone, she would have stopped getting chemotherapy a long time ago. But the reason why she was getting chemotherapy was because she wanted to make sure her husband was properly situated in their new place before she died. When that finally occurred, end of 2014, she elected to stop getting chemotherapy and died a couple months later. You see, my patients have taught me what love truly is. It is the exact reason that they choose to get chemotherapy, that they come as often as they do. Now, people at St. Luke's, many of the doctors I work with, they know me to be tenacious. They know that I will stop at nothing to try and find a better way to help a patient, that I'll do anything it takes. So when I had my twin boys, they thought, okay, this guy's gonna slow down. No way he can keep this pace up, not with twin boys. The fact of the matter is, when I had my twin boys, it made me work harder. It made me more intense. Because that love for a child that I can conceptualize now became a reality. And so these boys made it so that I worked harder, not less. The selflessness that I've seen as a cancer doctor is profound. And so now I'm going to tell you what I think are the best way to optimize your chance at survival, which is a very unique discussion that I haven't heard people really talk about in the past. Before I get there, before I take you behind the curtain, I want to make 2 disclaimers. First, the statements I'm making are a matter of my opinion and my opinion alone. Second, this talk will not refer to cancer survivorship in the classic sense of the word. Now, when I was at Stanford training as a hematology and oncology fellow, when I started in 2008, this concept of cancer survivorship was in its infancy. It had yet to reach the conscience of the oncology forum, Until recently, it was kind of an afterthought, but it's really become quite mainstream. And yet, nobody fully understands what it is. The reason why it exists, the reason it came into being, is the fact that over 12 million people currently are cancer survivors in the United States. That's more than the population of New York City. Now, in 2006, the Institutes of Medicine published a report titled From Cancer Patient to Cancer Survivor. In that report, it was made clear that cancer survivors have specific medical, physical, and emotional needs, and in many cases, those needs were not being met. It concluded by saying, the transition from active treatment to post-treatment care is critical to long-term health. Yet, despite this, no one really knows how to define cancer survivorship. It is, at the very least, an ambiguous term. There are, in fact, many different definitions of what a cancer survivor is, let alone what cancer survivorship entails. The National Cancer Institute defines a cancer survivor as anyone who has been diagnosed with cancer from the time of diagnosis through the rest of his or her life. Other organizations define cancer survivors to be people affected by the diagnosis, including family members, friends, and caregivers. To date, there have been some phenomenal speakers who have been in the same position as me and talked about cancer survivorship issues. We, through the St. Luke's Regional Cancer Center Survivorship Series, have talked about the physical and mental ramifications of a cancer treatment, the legal and financial implications of a cancer diagnosis and treatment, and cancer nutrition. Yet, that is not what I'm going to talk about today, because as I told you before, I'm not even really talking about cancer survivorship. This is a poem written by Dylan Thomas. Don't go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight, and learned too late they grieved it on its way. Do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. This talk is specifically designed to teach you how to rage against the dying of the light, designed to teach you how to optimize your chances at surviving cancer. Now, when I was thinking about this talk, I realized it was incredibly difficult to create a talk like this. The reason why is because cancer patients are not a homogeneous population. You can't talk about a patient with breast cancer the same way you talk about a patient with pancreatic cancer. You can't even talk about a patient with stage 1 breast cancer the way you talk about someone who has stage 4 breast cancer. The bottom line is patients have different types of tumors with different stages. They have different medical issues that they've had their whole life or recently. They have different social situations. So the bottom line is, there's no one size that fits all in cancer medicine. So how do you give a talk like this? How do you give a talk that's universally applicable when the population you're talking to is so heterogeneous? Now, a patient with ductal carcinoma in situ of the breast, they don't even need chemotherapy. Their chance at cure is well over 95%. Whereas a patient with stage 4 breast cancer, same type of cancer, different stage 4 breast cancer, they need chemotherapy or hormonal therapy indefinitely because their disease is incurable. No one on the planet knows how to cure stage 4 breast cancer. So those two people are not created equal. This is very eloquently stated without even using words by Holly Kitchen in this particular video that I'd like to show you now.
Small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. Can losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep, say I'm in too deep. It's been 2 years, I miss my home. There's a fire burning in my bones. I still believe, yeah, I still believe. And all those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove it, my right song. My power's turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes. Cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me.
Sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. This is my fight song. Take back my
So, Holly Kitchen says it better than I possibly could, but survival tip number one is understand your cancer. The best way to truly empower yourself is to understand your cancer. Know that cancer therapy and prognosis is highly nuanced and is dependent on the cancer type, stage, histology, and potentially its molecular profile. If you have cancer, know the stage, know what type you have, know the histology. That will help you long term. When I first meet a patient, as many of people in this room can attest, I spend a great deal of time educating them about their disease. In every single clinic room, I have a whiteboard, and I spend time writing on that whiteboard so my patients understand their disease, because I think it helps them optimize their chance at surviving. Now, cancer therapy and our understanding of cancer is changing at breakneck speeds. There are details regarding your cancer that we look at now that we did not look at 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Examples of that include the fact that if you have metastatic lung cancer, we look for these types of gene mutations. If you have breast cancer, we look at ER, PR, and HER2 status, as many of you know. If you have metastatic colon cancer or rectal cancer, we look at these different gene mutations. If you have melanoma, we look at this gene mutation. If you have a brain tumor like astrocytoma or glioma, we look for these mutations. If you have acute myeloid leukemia, we look for these mutations. The bottom line is, you should know these things. It will help you. I'm going to tell you how you can actually learn these things very easily about your type of cancer and your stage, and that will help you. The fact of the matter is, oncology is changing. The foreign oncology field is changing at breakneck speed. That is a great thing, okay? There are new drugs being tested every day. There are new drugs being FDA approved every day. So that's beautiful. That's excellent. The other thing about oncology, though, is even though it's changing at breakneck speed and there is a ton of information out there, and as big as the oncology world feels, it actually is readily accessible to you. The internet has made it so that this knowledge can be shared and everyone in this room can acquire it. Now, there are a couple of websites I'm going to talk about today. Now, I'm really taking you behind the curtain. I'm telling you things doctors don't normally tell you. Many of my patients already know these things because I'm their doctor. But a lot of doctors do not tell you this, and I think these websites are incredibly important. There's a website called nccn.org. NCCN stands for National Comprehensive Cancer Network. The National Cancer Comprehensive Network, Comprehensive Cancer Network, has been around for 20 years, 20 plus years. This site is useful for almost all, if not all, oncologists and hematologists. In fact, most oncologists in the country reference this site to determine how best to treat people just like you. Basically, some of the best people in the world at treating a respective tumor gather in a room, and they sit down and talk about patients just like you. And they determine the best way to treat patients just like you. All you have to do is go on the site, make a free account, and look at the NCCN guidelines for the tumor that you or a loved one has. You can read the syllabus at the back of the guidelines section, and you can ask your doctor to explain what you don't understand. But this is a perfect starting point for any of you who want to know what type of tumor you have and how it's treated. For the tumor you have and how it's treated. And if you're being treated optimally by your cancer doctor, this is a perfect place for you to go. These are guidelines, but your physician should have a good reason if they're deviating drastically from them. That is to say that when you read this, this isn't something that's dogmatic. But in general, if your physician's not doing what it says that people like you should have done, you should ask them why they're not. There should be a very good reason for it. This is the website, nccn.org. You're going to go here where it says new registrant and sign up for a free account. It's free. This is actually the doctor version of this website. I'm not taking you to the patient version. You can go look at the patient version, but that is not the best way to empower yourself to truly understand your cancer. Go to the doctor version. You'll understand it. If you don't, go to your doctor and they'll explain it to you. Okay? Bottom line is, go to this particular site, make a free page. Then you're gonna go to this NCCN guideline tab, and it'll be a pull-down menu, and just go for treatment by site, treatment of cancer by site. Then you get this kind of list. This is an abbreviated version of this list. It goes on and on with all these different types of cancers. So you just click on the cancer you're interested. So if you click on breast cancer, you get this. So this is a PDF file on breast cancer, okay? So then you just scroll down a little bit, and what you'll find is these people got in a room and talked about breast cancer. These are the top breast cancer people in the world. They sat down, they talked about patients just like you. Look at the centers that are represented here. Sloan Kettering is on here, number one center in the world. MD Anderson, number two center in the world for cancer. Fred Hutchinson, top 10 cancer center. Northwestern, Gratistar, he's one of the number one doctors, arguably the number one breast cancer doctor in the country. These people are sitting down and talking about people just like you. All you need to do then is just look at the kind of the section on stage, and you can find out what type of tumor you are, and then you can look and see what should be done for people like you. And you can go through this entire algorithm, and it will tell you very nicely what should be happening for you, what sort of treatment you should get. It's an excellent website for everyone in this room, for the most part, with some minor exceptions. So the bottom line is it's good for almost all patients, regardless of tumor type, stage, histology, molecular profile. For those patients with early stage tumors, many of you have already been treated for your cancer, right? You had cancer, you got treated from it, you're theoretically cured from it. This site is nice because it can tell you how we should surveil people like you. What sort of tests do you need now that you've beaten your cancer, so to speak? For patients with advanced stage tumors, this site can assist you in understanding the prognosis, the treatment options, etc. It can help instill confidence in your physician, because if you go to this site and you see what the standard of care is and your physician is doing that, you start to think, well, hey, I have a lot of confidence in my physician. That helps you see that your physician is doing the right thing for you. The second site I want to talk about is clinicaltrials.gov. The number of cancer therapeutics available today has exploded since the last several years. Since 2012, there have been at least 46 cancer drugs approved by the FDA. Numerous drugs are currently being tested in clinical trials to determine if they are safe and effective in patients with various types of tumors. There are people, and this is not an exaggeration, there are people who are alive today that would have died 10 years ago, if not for a clinical trial where they got on an experimental drug that they would otherwise not have received. This is a must-view site for those of you with quote-unquote incurable cancers, wishing to explore all therapeutic options. These trials can provide legitimate hope where there was none, and some of the most promising clinical therapeutics are only available via clinical trial. This site will tell you what clinical trials are available, what criteria are required for enrollment, and where they are located. It is updated frequently, making it worthwhile to check it relatively often, depending on your clinical situation. For those of you with a cancer that's essentially been cured, this site's probably not that useful for you. But for those of you with metastatic tumors, tumors that are considered incurable, this site is a necessity. Here's the site, clinicaltrials.gov. Very easy site, free, easy to access. All you need to do is put the type of tumor you're interested in right in the search box. When I put in this search for lung cancer, and I included just the studies that are open, there were 406 clinical trials in the United States currently open regarding lung cancer. 406. When I put the trials that were open and going to enroll or just recently completed, there were 1,432 studies in the United States currently open on lung cancer. And what's beautiful about this site is you can see where they are. Look here, in Minnesota, there are 100 plus clinical trials for lung cancer alone in Minnesota. Now, this is just one trial that I clicked on. This is a trial looking at one of the new immune-based therapies that's designed to recruit your immune system to attack your cancer for lung cancer. This is a trial where patients with metastatic lung cancer get this drug in first line, meaning it's their very first therapy. When you click on it, you can see where the sites that have this, what are the sites that have this trial available. We actually are one of the two sites in Minnesota that have this trial. This is us in Duluth. This is the Mayo Clinic in Rochester. So if you had metastatic lung cancer, this would be a trial that you should be very interested in, or if you had a loved one who had metastatic lung cancer, this would be a trial that would be very interesting to you. You would click on it, you would call these centers and see if they're enrolling. Make an appointment with them. I am a firm believer that a cancer center must have clinical trials to optimally treat most of its patients, or a number of its patients. When I became the director of St. Luke's Regional Cancer Center, I aggressively brought numerous trials to the center, and our clinical trial base is rapidly expanding. The only way sometimes to get the most promising drugs to a patient is through a clinical trial. That's why I was so adamant about bringing clinical trials to Duluth, because I knew I could not treat my patients effectively if I did not. Before I got some of these clinical trials, I was actually sending these people to the University of Minnesota, to the Mayo Clinic, to MD Anderson, to Sloan Kettering. I was sending them everywhere I had to get them on a drug I thought was promising, because I didn't have it. That's why I tried so hard to get these trials here. And that's why we have a tremendous framework to do that. If you want more information on this, you can read the article that was published in Duluthian Magazine, March, April 2015, talking about clinical trials helping advance treatment at our center. Third website I think everyone should know about. Website called pubmed.com. Again, free website, pubmed.com. This is a universally accessible website that allows the user to review the literature on any given subject. It's an excellent reference for those wanting to know what studies have been conducted on their tumor type. It is overwhelming for some, but your oncologist or hematologist can assist you in this regard. So here's the site. Okay, all you do is in the search box put what you're looking for. I put in metastatic lung cancer. When I put in metastatic lung cancer, 53,139 articles came up on metastatic lung cancer. So that's daunting. That's crazy. You can't read 53,000 articles unless you, maybe somebody can, but I can't. The bottom line is you can put in a more specific search and get what you are looking for. This is quite useful if you have an alternative therapy that you're interested in, that you may have read about. Vitamin B17 seems to be coming up a lot recently. You can go to this site and put in vitamin B17 and see if there's anything reputable that's been published on this particular vitamin. You'll find that there's not. But there are other alternative therapies you may be interested in. Go to this site and check them out. Additional websites that are excellent resources, www.cancer.gov. This is the official website of the National Cancer Institute. www.cancer.org. This is the official site of the American Cancer Society. www.asco.org, official site of the American Society of Clinical Oncology. The bottom line is, educate yourself, understand your tumor. Empower yourself by understanding your tumor. It is important. I don't care if you had cancer 17 years ago. Know what stage it was. Know what kind it was. Understand your cancer. It will help you. Understand how you're supposed to be watched at this point if you have a cancer that was considered cured. If you have a metastatic tumor, look and see if there's new stuff happening on that particular type of tumor, because it might save your life. It might extend it. Survival tip number two, choose your cancer doctor wisely. Now this sounds biased, but I am a firm believer that the cancer doctor you choose can make or break you in some regards. If you look at the American Cancer Society website, they state that choosing your cancer doctor and treatment center will be one of the most important decisions you will make. I would say the number one decision you make as a cancer patient is the cancer doctor you choose. If I had cancer, I would look very, very closely at the cancer doctor I chose. This is not an exact science, but it can make all the difference. Standard things to look for when you're evaluating your cancer doctor is where they trained at. That sometimes is helpful. Now, I want everyone to hear me when I say this. There are doctors who trained at institutions with lesser names that are phenomenal. They're great. And there are doctors who trained at tremendous institutions who are terrible. So this isn't a deal breaker. But the bottom line is, if they have a very good training record, they've been in the best institutions, they probably have seen some of the cutting edge therapies. And that might prove useful to you. You want to know if they have a commitment to clinical research. I already told you how important clinical trials are. If they don't have a commitment to clinical research, they will not be thinking about clinical trials. And for some of you, that could make or break you. There are people, as I mentioned before, who got a drug like ipilimumab or pembrolizumab or nivolumab for their metastatic melanoma that should have died 10 years ago. But they're alive 10 years later without any evidence of disease, and they may have a long, long life. It is incredibly important. Look at patient reviews. Go to the sites, healthstream.org or vitals.com. There's a million of these. Go to them. Look and see what these sites say about your doctor. For those of you that have not gone to them, one thing that would be quite helpful for other patients is if you go to them and fill out a review on your doctor. You're helping other people in doing that, for those of you that want to do that, but this is also a very good reference for yourself. Check your friends and family. They might know someone that's quite useful to you. When you go see the doctor, how much time did they spend with you? Did you feel rushed? Did they make you leave the room? I have 25 to 30 patients I see sometimes on a day. It was one day I saw 41. And yet I make a point out of ensuring that my patients never feel rushed. It is sometimes why I'm 2 hours late, for those of you in this room that have seen me be 2 hours late. That is why. It's not because I'm hanging out eating lunch or going somewhere to do so. Do they listen to you? When you see your doctor, do they listen to you? Or are they ignoring you? What's their experience level? Now this, you need to take with a grain of salt too. Some of the newer people, they know some of the newer therapies that can be useful to you, but you kind of want this perfect balance between experience and knowledge of new things. Now, more experienced people can know all the new stuff, so this is kind of one of those things you take with a grain of salt. And your comfort level. This is maybe the most important facet, actually, of choosing your doctor. This is someone who's going to be with you the rest of your life. You need to find the right person. You need to be comfortable with them. You want a physician who treats you holistically and can see the big picture. You know, when I was at Stanford, some of my attendings, as amazing as they were, would never want to hear about other medical issues related to their patient. You know, a patient would come with high blood pressure. They'd make that patient call their primary care doctor to have their blood pressure checked and worked on. Come on, I'm an internist. I do blood pressure every day. Why would I make you see someone else, make a separate appointment, if I can take care of it right there? Why would I want more cooks in the kitchen? It doesn't make any sense. You want a doctor who can see you holistically and look at all the issues and treat you in that manner. You want a doctor with a big heart, with a heart that is of good quality. This is the number one thing I think you need to look for in a doctor. It's what I would look for. I had a 19-year-old patient with metastatic neuroblastoma come to St. Luke's with new pelvic fractures, tremendous pain in her pelvis. And I knew when I met her that I wasn't the right guy for her. I knew that I was not the one that should take care of her because I don't know how to treat neuroblastoma. I'm not the right person. In 2 days, I called 9 different institutions despite the fact I had 25 to 30 people a day. I called Sloan Kettering and MT Anderson and St. Jude's and Stanford and National Cancer Institute and University of Minnesota, because I tried to find someone better for her. We ended up sending her to New York for someone who's more qualified to see her. What made me call those 9 people was not my mind. When you're exhausted and tired and you got nothing left in the tank, it's not your mind that compels you to do the extra work, it's your heart. When I came on as the director of the St. Luke's Regional Cancer Center, and I had to hire some oncologists to join my group, the very first thing I assessed as best I could was the quality of their heart. See, when the mind doesn't know the answer, it's the heart that compels the mind to go find it. It is the reason I don't sleep at night very well because I'm constantly thinking about patients. It's not that my mind is running on its own. It's that my heart is compelling my mind to run on its own or to run that way. The heart of your doctor is something we oftentimes underestimate, but it is of incredible importance. Can make or break what happens with you. Ideally, you want someone who gives you the best of their heart and the best of their mind. You want this perfect balance, hard to find. I don't think I have it, but there are doctors who do. I trained under some of them, they're phenomenal. You want that. You want a doctor who thinks out the box when the time is required. There are tumors that we treat, rare tumors, that there's no data for. Or you have a metastatic tumor, a stage 4 tumor, where you've exhausted all the conventional options. You need a doctor who's not gonna throw their hands up if you still wanna be aggressive with your treatment and say, okay, we're done, something more we can do. You want a doctor who's willing to go outside the box, think about everything. Did they think about sending you to MD Anderson or Sloan Kettering or Johns Hopkins or anywhere in the country to try and improve your chances at surviving? Did they think about radiation or surgery, any other treatment modality? Did they do everything possible to try and buy you more time? Did they think outside the box? Did they leave their comfort zone? You want a doctor who's going to do that if you have a particular situation. And when all else fails, if you don't feel comfortable, just ask your primary care physician who they would go to if they had cancer. Some of my smartest patients, when there's a fork in the road and we're trying to decide what to do next, will ask me, if this was your mom, what would you do? If this was you, what would you do? That is always the right question to ask, by the way. I don't care if you have cancer or not. If you're seeing a doctor and there's something that's going on, that's what you ask them. You say, if you're in my position, or if this was your mom, or your dad, or your son, what would you do? So if you're looking for a cancer doctor, you can call your doctor and say, if you had cancer, your mom had cancer, etc., where would you send them? Who would you let take care of them? Survival tip number 3, the inches matter.
I don't know what to say, really. 3 minutes till the biggest battle of our professional lives all comes down to today. Either we heal as a team or we're gonna crumble. Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, gentlemen. Believe me. And we can stay here, get the shit kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back into the light. We can climb out of hell. 1 inch at a time. Now, I can't do it for you. I'm too old. I look around, I see these young faces, and I think, I mean, I made every wrong choice a middle-aged man can make. I pissed away all my money, believe it or not. I chased off anyone who's ever loved me. And lately, I can't even stand the face I see in a mirror. You know, when you get old in life, things get taken from you. I mean, that's part of life. But you only learn that when you start losing stuff. You find out life's this game of inches. So is football. Because in either game, life or football, the margin for error is so small. I mean, one half a step too late or too early, and you don't quite make it. One half second too slow, too fast, you don't quite catch it. The inches we need are everywhere around us.
Hell yeah.
They're in every break of the game, every minute, every second. On this team, we fight for that inch. On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch.
Yeah.
We claw with our fingernails for that inch. Because we know when we add up all those inches, that's gonna make the fucking difference between winning and losing. Between living and dying. I'll tell you this, in any fight, it's the guy who's willing to die who's gonna win that itch. And I know if I'm gonna have any life anymore, it's because I'm still willing to fight and die for that itch.
Cancer care, the inches are literally everywhere. In a patient with a neutropenic fever, so that's a fever after you've had cancer where your neutrophil count's less than 500, we already know as a medical field that if we delay therapy an extra hour, mortality goes up. Patients die. Just an hour. In patients who are desperate to get on a clinical trial, I have several of them actually desperate to get on a clinical trial. If those trials are full, patients can die because the trial was full. They had their cancer too early or too late. There was no spot available for them. There are drugs that I am waiting for to get FDA approved because I can't get them on trial, and I'm desperately waiting for these drugs to come out. And there are drugs in some of my patients who have metastatic lung cancer where I'm waiting and they're going to come out in 3 months, but I don't know if my patients have 3 months. They may die in 3 months. In fact, that's a realistic possibility for a lot of my patients. Again, the inches are everywhere. In a patient who is dehydrated due to diarrhea, nausea, and vomiting, if they ignore it just a little too long, that can cause renal failure, and that renal failure can be permanent. In a patient who has back pain that they ignore, that could be representative of a metastatic tumor, that could result in spinal cord compression, and now they end up paralyzed and can't fix it. In a patient with headaches that they ignore, that could be representative of a tumor that went to the brain that could take someone's life if they wait too long. In a patient with an abnormal mole that chooses to ignore it, this can be the difference between an atypical mole or a stage 4 metastatic melanoma that kills the patient. And in patients who don't get their timely screening tests, that can be the difference between stage 1 colon cancer that's very easily treated or stage 4 colon cancer that there's no known cure for. The inches are everywhere in this business. Melissa already kind of told you this story, but I'll tell you from my perspective the same story. I was on call and working pretty late at night, so Melissa came to me and showed me this lymph node, I believe it was in the left supraclavicular area. Told me she went to urgent care, they dismissed it, they thought it was benign, nothing. The minute I felt it, because of where it was located, I knew it was cancer. Because of where it was located. I immediately got her set up to have it biopsied, we did the scans, I knew that was cancer. I had a 64-year-old male, stage 2 bulky Hodgkin's lymphoma. He was my patient a couple months ago. He had about 85% plus chance of being cured. And so his treatment basically was just 12 cycles or 6 cycles of ABVD given in 12 separate treatments. Okay? After 4 treatments, 2 cycles, his scan showed a complete remission. This guy was definitely going to be cured. No chance he's not cured. With this PET-CT after 4 cycles showing complete remission like that, chance of being cured 90% plus. Another 2 cycles, 4 treatments, he does perfectly, scans look perfect. Finally, at about 6 months' time, in the week just before we're completely done, after he's had his 12th treatment, so the week after he gets his 12th treatment, he goes to his emergency room, local ER, he lived very far away, goes to the local ER, says, look, I'm really short of breath, I'm not feeling well. They send him home. Thought it was benign. Goes back a day later, sent him home again. Calls me the next day. Tells me something's not right. So I bring him in that very day, that very moment, he comes to see me. When I saw him in my clinic, I knew I was in trouble. I knew that too much time had probably elapsed, and I was probably never going to be able to save him. Because at that point, his immune system was so compromised, and I knew he had a profound pneumonia. All the tests ended up showing he had an MRSA pneumonia. He died a couple days later. Now, if Melissa doesn't come to me and ask me to check the lymph node, her disease is worse, and we may be in a different situation. Expect her to have a very long life. My patient comes to me a day or two earlier. He's still alive today and cured of his cancer. The inches in my business and your business are everywhere. If you are concerned, call your doctor. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if they get annoyed. If they get annoyed, find a new doctor. Honestly, what are you paying them for? They're not there, okay, as a doctor. I'm not there for just the good times, right? What you really need from me is to be there in case something goes wrong. For my breast cancer patients who had breast cancer 10 years ago, and I see them once a year, what they really come to see me for, it's not to make sure they don't have breast cancer anymore. That's easy to do. Anyone can do that. They can feel your breasts. What you are really seeing me for is to have me in your back pocket. So if something goes wrong, I'm there. And you're also seeing me to detect if something's wrong as soon as possible. So you can never call too much. I tell my patients this. Listen, you can never call me too much, but you can call too little. You can call too little. You don't tell me about a fever. You don't tell me about a pain that's lingering. That could be the difference between life and death. The inches in this business are incredibly important. Now, this is a list of symptoms that I think comprise what inches in my business are. Fevers, night sweats, inadvertent weight loss, new onset shortness of breath, headaches that are frequent in the absence of a headache history or wake you up from sleep, blood in your stool, black stool in the absence of iron consumption, back pain that is new, bone pain that is new, blood in your urine, dehydration, uncontrollable diarrhea or vomiting, new onset chest pain, new or atypical moles that are changing. This is just a small list, but these are what I think the inches are. Now, I told you that in my business, there are next to no generalities, but there is one that I can think of. The earlier, the better. The earlier you let me know about a symptom, the easier I can treat it. The earlier we can catch your cancer, generally the better you'll do. And that is all about the inches. Survival tip number 4, don't forget what you are fighting for. This sounds stupid, and I feel foolish even saying it, because I've never had cancer. I don't know what it's like to have cancer. And I am a firm believer that you cannot know what it is like to have cancer until you have had cancer. I don't care if you see cancer every day, you don't know what it's like. But as a cancer doctor, when people are in the throes of fighting their tumor, sometimes I see people who are living simply to not die. I don't know how that happens. People get tired, but they continue to do it. What I will say is don't ever lose the forest through the trees. Remember what it is you are fighting for. Stay true to that which bewilders you and find solace in it. Come back to it. Sometimes the journey is brutal. It's not easy. Remember what it is you are fighting for. Remember the love that you are pursuing. Survival tip number 5. You are the captain of this boat. When I first meet people, a lot of the time I'll tell them, look, I'm the navigator. You're the captain. It's your boat. I give you the options, the potential paths you could take, but bottom line is, it's your boat. We do what you want. You give me the path that you want to take, and I'll try and get you there. You are what matters, not the ego of your cancer doctor, not even what people around you are telling you to do. You are what matters. If you're not happy with your navigator, ask for a new one. Get a second opinion if you're concerned. It's your life. Who gives a crap about the ego of the doctor standing in front of you? All that matters is you. So ask for a second opinion. You don't like your cancer doctor? Get a new navigator. If your family is pressuring you to a decision, sit with them. Tell them what you feel. Tell them whether or not you want to go through that way. Now, I just read a story about a 22-year-old female who has cystic fibrosis, and she needs a lung and heart transplant. And she opted to take herself off the transplant list because she wants to go travel. She wants to go enjoy her life. And that made a lot of her family members pretty angry. But when all is said and done, I understand her decision. You know, it's her boat, and she's the captain. And I think it was an incredibly beautiful decision that she made. Survival tip number 6. Cancer is a marathon, it is not a sprint. There is never a cancer patient who has a very short race. Once you're diagnosed with cancer, it's always there. It's always in your conscience somehow. You're always thinking about it to some extent. You have a weird symptom. You think, oh, is this my cancer? So I've always considered my patients to be marathon runners. And as a doctor, I feel like my role changes a lot. Sometimes my patients need me to be in the lead car guiding them. Sometimes they need to be the runner that's pacing them next to them. Sometimes they need me just to hand them a glass of water. And sometimes they literally need me to put them on my back and carry them across the finish line or to keep them going. The same holds true of their family members. They need their family members to be in the lead car guiding them at times, or next to them pacing them, or giving them a glass of water at times, or literally putting them on their back to get them through. Surround yourself by people, doctors, etc., who can help you run this race. Now, William Shakespeare once wrote, "All the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players." I'm a firm believer that once you're diagnosed with cancer, that stage, the backdrop upon which your entire life is run, changes. It's forever altered by a cancer diagnosis. That's why people who were diagnosed with cancer 20 years ago and cured of their cancer are in this room today. It never really changes. It's always there somehow. So, in summary, in terms of optimizing your chances at surviving cancer, there are 6 survival tips I'm giving you today. There's a million more I could have given you. I could have made this a 10-hour lecture. Honestly, there's a lot out there. But these are 6 survival tips that you can kind of guide yourself and use. Now, as people, I've always felt that we are a conglomeration of our experiences. We are what we lived. I've always equated my interactions with my patients as collisions of sorts. Sometimes, even when the visit is short and the time I spend with them is brief, there's a transfer of pain, even if it's imperceptible. There's a transfer of pain from me onto them and them onto me. But more often than not, my collisions with my patients leave me totaled, completely wrecked. My wife will tell you I don't sleep very well at night. She'll tell you that she's seen me break down at times because it's too hard at times. She'll tell you that the job takes a toll. But my patients have taught me what love is, what humanity is, and I don't know how to be different as a cancer doctor. My heart and my mind only know one speed when it comes to my patients. You know, my mentors used to tell me at Stanford, you're gonna burn out, you can't be like this. You need to just detach a little bit or desensitize yourself. And the fact of the matter is I probably someday will burn out. I don't think I'll do this career my whole life. I don't think it's possible. But until then, my flame will burn vigorously. And I will burn as bright as I can until I burn out, because that's the only way I know how to be a doctor. My patients are like my family. Many of you in this room, like family to me. When my kids were born, my patients were as excited as I was. I've had patients tell me they love me, and vice versa. And I've been honored to be there. I can tell you that when I'm looking at a radiology report to see if someone's disease has progressed, as I'm clicking the button to look at the report, I cringe, I'm nervous, because I'm worried about what I'm gonna see. Because it hurts when a patient's disease has gotten worse. I can tell you a story. I was at Target one day, and I saw the wife of a patient who I just lost to pancreatic cancer. She was at the cash register. So I literally hid behind the clothing rack because they didn't want her to see me until she was done, because I didn't want to reopen her wounds. I didn't want her to feel that way again. I'm honored to be a cancer doctor, honored to have been able to tell you this story and to talk to you about this. I can tell you that my grandmother, she did what she did so she could have one moment with us. Thank you for your time.
I hope you'll never lose your sense of wonder. You get your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger. May you never take one single breath for granted. God forbid love ever leaves you empty-handed. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice, sit it out or dance.
I hope you dance.
Settle for the path of least resistance. Living might mean taking chances, but they're worth taking. Loving might be a mistake, but it's worth making. Don't let some helping heart leave you bitter. When you come close to selling out, reconsider. Give the heavens above more than just a passing glance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or to dance, I hope you dance. The ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance. Pray you're dancing. I hope you're dancing.